Hello, space fans. Welcome to another edition of Space Fan News. This week, Hubble sees a giant gas cloud the size of a galaxy swirling towards us. ESO's VLT images a nearby galaxy with remarkable clarity and updates on new content for deep astronomy. Astronomers using the Hubble Space Telescope have measured and characterized an enormous galaxy-sized cloud of dust swirling around the Milky Way. Known as the Smith Cloud because it was named after the grad student who discovered it in the 1960s, Gale Smith, this cloud has long been the subject of speculation and theory. It was initially found using radio telescopes, receiving signals at the 21-centimeter line of hydrogen, and until very recently, not a whole lot was known about it. However, new Hubble observations suggest it was launched from the outer regions of the galactic disk around 70 million years ago. Now, this gas cloud is huge and roughly the size of a small galaxy. It measures 11,000 light-years long and 2,500 light-years across, and it is whizzing around our galaxy at about 1.1 million kilometers per hour. Now, if you could look up and see this in the night sky, which you can because it's way too dim in visible light, it would take up an area of the sky 30 times greater than the size of the full moon. Now, for years, many astronomers thought it was either a so-called failed galaxy, which is just a massive cloud where stars never formed, or maybe this was just a huge gas cloud coming at us from intergalactic space. But if either of those explanations were true, then we'd expect to see mainly hydrogen and helium in the cloud, and not the heavier elements made by stars. However, if it came from within our galaxy, then it would contain more of the elements found within our Sun. So, to try and settle the matter, astronomers using the Cosmic Origins Spectrograph on Hubble took a look at what the cloud was made up of by measuring the light passing through the cloud from distant cores of three active galaxies billions of light-years behind the cloud. In particular, they looked for sulfur in the cloud, which can absorb ultraviolet light, and these are wavelengths that Hubble detectors are sensitive to. Now, sulfur, it turns out, is a good gauge of how many heavier elements reside in the cloud. The astronomers found that the Smith Cloud is as rich in sulfur as the Milky Way's outer disk, a region about 40,000 light-years from the galaxy center, and it's about 15,000 light-years farther out than our Sun and solar system. This means that the Smith Cloud was enriched by material from stars. This would not happen if it were from pristine hydrogen from outside the galaxy, or if it were the remnant of a failed galaxy devoid of stars. So while this settles many questions about the Smith Cloud, like what it's made of, how big it is, and how fast it's going, astronomers still don't know what kicked it out of the galaxy in the first place. Now, one theory is that maybe a huge passing clump of dark matter came through and churned it up and causing it to spew out of the plane of the galaxy. But they aren't too sure about that. Oh yeah, and one thing I may have forgotten to mention, the trajectory of the cloud was measured such that it's plummeting back down towards our galaxy center. And us. Now, the cloud does not pose any threat to our Sun or solar system, but when it hits the core of our galaxy, a chain reaction of starburst will be set off that should be spectacular to watch in about 30 million years. I'll keep you posted. Next, astronomers using ESO's VLT survey telescope have looked at a small galaxy in our local group named IC-1613 and concluded that, yep, it is indeed in our local group. And it's also clean, very clean. IC-1613 lies just over 2.3 million light-years away from us. It is relatively well studied due to its proximity, and astronomers have found it to be an irregular dwarf. Now, this isn't a judgment. It's a name given to a galaxy that lacks many of the features, such as a starry disk, which are found in some other galaxies. There is also very little dust getting in the way of observing its constituent stars, as well as the fact that there is very little dust between us and it. This tidiness has allowed astronomers over the years to learn quite a bit about IC-1613. Now, because we have such a clear view, we can see the standard candles that reside in the galaxy very clearly, which means we can measure its distance very accurately. Now, a standard candle is something astronomers use to measure distance. They are objects that we know their intrinsic brightness to a very high level, which allows us to infer their distances based on their brightness. Cepheid variables in type 1a supernovae are standard candles, for example. A Cepheid variable changes in brightness at a rate that is proportional to their intrinsic brightness, and using them, astronomers have pieced together a cosmic distance ladder reaching deeper and deeper into space. So this week, astronomers got some very clear pictures of this little galaxy using OMEGACam, which is a 32 CCD 256 million pixel camera mounted on the 2.6 meter VLT survey telescope at Paranal Observatory in Chile. Now finally, as you may have noticed, that last story was just a little bit of a puff piece, just a pretty picture story that I picked because, well, to be honest, this week was a little light on the interesting astronomy stories front. And by interesting, I mean interesting to me. So I'm going to use my last little SFN segment to give you news about what's coming up for the Deep Astronomy Channel and Space Fan News. Now, if you follow me on Twitter or Facebook, then you've probably learned that I'm doing content for Deep Astronomy full-time now, which means that there's more time for me to make a lot more stuff. More space videos, more hangouts, more podcasts, all kinds of things. Now, depending on how you feel about me and this channel, that may or may not be a good thing. But this year, we've got lots of new things planned starting next week. First up, podcasts. Lots of podcasts. I want to build a presence in the audio podcasting world, and we're going to start with a brand new one coming out next week, This Week in Space Telescopes. Now, what that podcast is each week, Dr. Carol Christian and I will discuss the latest science and mission news for anything related to the world of space telescopes and humanity's eyes in space. Now, I just submitted that podcast to iTunes just today, and I'm waiting for word on getting it into the iTunes store. And I've also submitted it to Stitcher as well. Now, once that comes out on iTunes, I'll go ahead and I'll be sure to let you guys know. Now, the home of the podcast is on SoundCloud, and the first episode is already up. So if you just can't wait for it to get on iTunes, you can get it from soundcloud.com/twistpodcast. Now, I'm also starting a Deep Astronomy podcast, which is basically just me rambling about things like great filters, which I just did two of, how I overcame my math blocks, which is coming up next, how to get a job in astronomy, what telescopes are best, and how much you should pay, stuff like that. And that'll be released sometime in March, because I gotta stagger this stuff, you know. Now, also starting this month, in fact, it'll be the first Friday of every month, which is coming right up, Alberto Conti, Harley Thronson, and I will be holding a new hangout series called Footsteps to Mars, where we will talk with scientists and engineers working on a manned, on-demand mission to Mars. And the first hangout will feature guests from the Goddard Space Flight Center who are trying to work out the best landing places to send the first manned mission. I also have two space videos in progress now, one on WFIRST, the Wide Field Infrared Survey Telescope, and another one on Juno, which is the mission to Jupiter expected to arrive in July of this year. Now, all of that is in addition to the regular stuff. SFN every Friday, thanks to the Patreon supporters who make that happen, and Hubble Hangouts, which happen every Thursday on Hubble Site Channel. And let's not forget the Future in Space Hangouts that we hold every third Friday of the month. Now, that's a lot of astronomy content. I know you don't want to miss any of it, so I would highly encourage you to follow me on Twitter. That's at Deep Astronomy. And also on Periscope, too, because I do a lot of that these days as well, especially right before the Hubble Hangouts. Now, another good way to be notified of at least the live events is to subscribe to the Deep Astronomy Facebook events page. And the link to that is in the doobly-doo. Can't believe I said that. With apologies to John and Hank. Well, that's it for this week, space fans. Thanks for watching, and thanks to all of you who provide support on Patreon. I couldn't do it without you. And as always, keep looking up.